we all found ourselves in created lots of challenges. So in this meeting, we will focus on sharing knowledge about the changes in practice that we are instituting and to be able to provide continuing service to our clients in particular and our communities in general. A few simple rules for this webinar. One, please keep your microphones on mute. Any comments or questions that you have during the presentations can be sent at any time through the chat, and we will look at them and try and pick out the most relevant ones. In the next few days, we'll send you a link to the recording of this webinar, as well as the results of the seminar, of the survey, sorry. And unfortunately, since periodically Zoom has been hacked and has had problems, if this should happen to us, we will simply disconnect this current meeting and send you all a new link right away. So what we would hope to do in this meeting is to present and discuss the survey results, highlight some of the recommendations for best practices that you've mentioned in the survey, and possibly ideas that you come up with for discussion during the meeting. Before we begin, I'd like to give a special thanks to our colleagues at the International Federation of Social Workers for their assistance, both in sharing the questionnaire and in helping to publicize this event this evening. So thank you to Rory Truel, the Secretary General, Lola Casal Sanchez, the International Relations Manager, and Teodora Dobre, the Honorary Secretary of the European Region. Now I would like to invite several people to also offer some welcoming remarks. So I'd like to invite, first of all, Iris Florentine, who is the Deputy Director General and the head of the Division for Personal and Social Services of the Ministry of Social Affairs and Social Services. So, Iris, if you could open your microphone.
My microphone is open. I'm very happy to be next to you. It's amazing to be here with 250 social workers all over the world and in Israel. I think the coronavirus has put us all together to work quietly and do a great deal of jobs. I think everybody's talking about the medical people, the doctors, but the social workers are working together 24 hours a day and doing the work very quietly as we all think together of being there for our clients at the right time and avoiding having difficulties for the clients and the families and being there 1 minute before there will be a catastrophe. We're thinking about opening services. The main deal is putting a plan that all the services that can work with clients will be always open and open 100% all day long, and making the services adapt to the right issues of the coronavirus, which means being there 1 minute before the catastrophe is there, a family catastrophe, a violent catastrophe, and being at the right moment to help. Opening the services for new clients that are coming nowadays before of the coronavirus, and being there with the right services and opening for right work done, together with giving help to the social workers that are working there with the clients and seeing different kinds of work done in the community, in the new kinds of hot hospitals where we work there, also with the new clients that are closed over there and working all day long. I'm very happy to be with all of us together and hear and listen to different kinds of methods and thinking, and also what's going on with all of us together with the work done. Have a nice evening, Erev Tov.
Thank you very much, Iris. And now a few words from Gil Rivosh, the director of the Community Services Administration in the Jerusalem municipality.
Hi, good evening. Thank you all for this webinar and for the opportunity. I want to say a few words about the situation in Jerusalem regarding the welfare services when the coronavirus broke down. So Jerusalem was the capital of Israel, around 1 million residents, and very diverse. 40% are Arabs, 25% are ultra-Orthodox, very poor. And with the coronavirus broke into our lives, we had to deal all of a sudden with a lot more clients than we used to, from 15,000 residents from the elderly population. Now we've got 85,000 that we need to take care of or at least be in touch with, from 4% unemployment to 26% in 1 week. So in 1 week or two, we had to manage a whole different system, not to only watch our clients, but many of the residents in Israel. And we had a lot of constraints in our own world. We have employees that were sick. We had employees that couldn't come to work. Our regular methods were affected. We couldn't meet clients. We couldn't make rallies or classes or whatever. And we had to find a way through that system really, really fast. I think that this crisis had a lot of opportunities. The first one is collaborations and coordination with different systems, the health system, different civic organizations, our colleagues from different departments in the municipalities, and even the army and the police became in the last 6 weeks our partners day to day. And I think this is something that is more opportunity than a challenge. And I think that if we look ahead, we can profit from this experience. Even though we have a lot of challenges, there were some opportunities that we don't have in the regular basis. One was the attention of the leaders of the city and many others. Everyone understood that now welfare and the elderly population and other residents that are more poor or less privileged need our attention. And we had more budget and more resources. The education system, workers.
Yeah, just a one more minute, please.
Yeah, of course. Everyone contribute to our effort. And when I look at the new future, I think our main challenges will be managing all the data to create a system that they can relate to residents in other methods. And of course, how we can make the elderly population carry out this period of time of the corona in the best quality of life that we can achieve.
Okay, Gil, thank you very much. And our final introduction is Inbal Hermoni, the chairperson of the Israel Union of Social Workers. Inbal.
Hi, thank you, Brian. Hi, everybody. So I will speak quickly. Just want to say welcome, and also that it's really excited to see all of you from a lot of countries from all over the world, and also from Israel, from Jerusalem. And I want to say also that this crisis is it's a health crisis. It's also economical, but it's definitely a social social problem that is now ahead of us. We can feel it already now, but we know that it's also going to be after the corona, the health situation will end. All of us will have to take care of the things that will happen due to this virus and due to the economical situation. And I'm really, really proud to be part of a profession that this is what we know to do. And this is what we are doing also in regular times, but also in times like this. So it's, I think we have a lot of, it makes our life really meaningful. And I just hope, and the more than hope, I know that in Israel we are going to, if we need, we will also, we'll act for it. So that all of us will have enough enough money and enough power from the governments that of in all of our countries to make our work in the best way we can. So I like to say that again that I hope it will be a good, nice, and interesting evening for all of us. And thank you.
Thank you, Inbal. And I'd also like to welcome Ana Radulescu from Romania, who is the European president of the International Federation of Social Workers. Ana? No?
I hope you see me now. Yeah, yes. I did. Good evening. Thank you very much, Inbal and Brian, for organizing this. The collection of data, but also this webinar, it's really valuable for us. IFSW Europe is collecting now all the experiences in Europe, so I'm looking forward for all the presentation tonight. I saw here Charlene from Malta. Yesterday, Malta had a webinar, so we are collecting and putting together all these experiences, and I hope we can give it as a possibility for people to learn from everything we went through. It was a very difficult time for all of us. I look forward. Thank you very much for organizing all this event tonight.
Thank you, Ana. Okay, so a little bit of background. The a little bit more than a month ago, at least in Israel, everything pretty much changed overnight. The government declared that workplaces would be closed, and there was no time for preparation. So one of the ideas that came out of my, the beginning was my colleague from Jerusalem, Rinat Salem, who came with the idea that we put together a brief survey to see what is happening with social workers as all over the world, as many as we can get, as many results as we can get. We wanted to identify the challenges that people were facing and to hear about the innovative interventions and best practices. The response to the survey was way beyond our expectations. We received over 200 responses. When we first started talking about it, somebody said we would be lucky if we received 25. So we figured we were doing pretty well. And that, given the fact that everybody was overwhelmed with heavy workloads, and you still found time to write back to us. Even more surprising were the results and some of the important information that we gathered. So I would like to invite Dr. Aviv Landau, a postdoctoral fellow at the Data Science Institute in Columbia University, to present a summary of the findings. And I would just remind you again that if you have any comments or questions from some of the information you hear, write them down in the chat and we will try and relate to it afterwards. Thank you. Aviv.
Thank you very much, Brian. Hello, thank you very much for all the social workers joining us today. I would like to present the findings from the survey on social work practice and challenges during COVID-19. We had about 220 respondents from about 20 countries from all over the world. As you can see, Greece, Malta, Spain, Canada, and more and more other countries. So there has been a lot of challenges and changes in the field of social work. 44% of the respondents are saying that they're working only from home. Another 19% are working from home and from their work. So that's 66% working from home settings part of the week. How social workers are contacting their clients has also changed rapidly during this. 94% of the social workers are in contact through phone, another 71% through emails. We have 40% from Skype, Zoom, and other video conference applications. And we have 40% of the respondents communicating with their client through social media or text. Interesting, only 42% of the social workers are meeting face-to-face, which is for sure in our profession a big change. The main activities or main interventions that are taking place right now is 83% are giving emotional support. Another 58% have said that they're giving information about rights. An interesting fact is that 42% are helping to provide food, which will impact us in society for sure. 37%, as you can see, are providing parenting advice, which is also interesting. And there's other interventions and needs that us as social workers are giving to our clients. We have a couple of dilemmas and challenges that we have seen, and the social workers have been talking about through their qualitative data that we have gathered. There is employee resilience, talking about fear, bureaucracy, working from home, access to technology, digital literacy, working with vulnerable and marginalized communities, physical distancing ourselves from the clients, and more. And I will give you a couple of examples. So here you are in regarding resilience. I'm exposing myself and indirectly my family to an increased level of risk, but I strongly feel that I have a duty to my clients to be there. The danger to ourselves and our clients when we meet face to face. So social workers are talking not only to the danger to themselves and the families, but also to the danger of meeting clients, and they may be social workers and clients may have the virus themselves. And this is, and there is a lot of fear around this issue. Technology challenges, how to build a relationship with clients without any real live meetings. Our service are digitalized, but not all of our clients have the skills or even have internet at home. So this is for, in my perspective, one of the biggest challenges. How do we reduce the digital divide, as we're working with marginalized communities that may not have access to internet or technology or smartphones? How do we intervene? How do we communicate with them? How do we build relationships? How do we keep our relationships without meeting them? We are also social distancing ourselves. And it could be face-to-face, but also through technology. How do we support immigrants? How do we support refugees, homeless, drug users? How do we establish new relationships with new clients? These are all questions that we gathered from the qualitative survey. So we have a couple of examples of innovations from around the world. Social work is going digital, utilizing apps and technology, WhatsApp, Teams, Zoom, YouTube, and social media to communicate with clients. Design of registration tools, online training, phone screening, online exercise programs based on needs, departments, and social workers. Introduction of phone screening for new referrals for immediate needs and assessment of emotional support. And an Icelandic entrepreneur has developed an online therapy platform that has been approved by the authorities, where Skype, social media, and other platforms are not safe. On this platform, we can take live interviews and connect with the clients. We have developed 24 telephone attention shifts, widening our attention outside of our normal schedule in order to deal with emergencies and urgent issues. So as you can see, a lot of social workers are being creative and using technology as an innovation for intervention and even detection to new clients and clients that we know and are in regular day-to-day contact with. So what are the lessons learned and what are the suggestions given by our colleagues? So we have digital interventions, as we said, the role of social work has already changed. So us as social workers, we are now knowing that from a traditional profession, we are becoming digital social workers in a lot of ways, faster than ever before. We have to adapt our work from face-to-face to remote, and we should examine all the alternatives such as social apps. So we have to also develop our ethical guidelines and using social media as well. These are things that we can discuss later on. Emotional support, not only for the clients, but for ourselves. So we have colleagues saying to one another, don't stop believing in yourself. Support colleagues and provide solidarity. Personal safety, we should take into account our safety as ourselves also, meaning we have to provide our physical safety and not forget about that. Professional practice, focus and identify priorities of intervention, be active to contact patients, identify who needs support. So as social workers, we have to remember that we are, although in this time of emergency, we have to work with our clients and give them the support needed. Focus and identify priorities of intervention. Be active to contact patients, identify who needs support because unemployment will raise and the secure income have diminished. So this is one of the biggest problems that we're dealing right now, and we will deal in the near future as well. Unemployment around the world has risen to high rent rates than ever before, and we will be in the front line dealing with these new families and clients and communities that we are working with. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Aviv. Okay, for the international perspective, we have speakers from Italy, Portugal, and of course, Israel. So I would like to invite Paola Pontarola from Italy to talk about the Italian experience. Paola is the president of the Italian Association of Social Workers and is a social worker in the Ministry of Justice working on criminal rehabilitation. So, Paola, can you open your microphone?
Good evening to everybody. Do you send me? Yeah?
We hear you.
Okay. And in Italy, it's a very particular situation, so very hard. We arrived near 28 miles dead, and it's a so strong situation. The situation exploded 2 months ago, and there isn't in Italy a plane for emergency. And in these 2 months, there is a new organization. It's a very different situation in the Italian social service system. A lot of service have smart working, and there is a circularity of present of the operators in service. And some service go normal at work. This is a different situation because it's a different decision from the political service. And it's a very, very particular situation because we can meet the clients. It's the same for Italy. We also can call the people, can write by mail or meet by Skype. There is in Italy, there is a most important cooperation about the private resource. In particular, social service have coordination the voluntary resource. About private association with voluntary people. And in this organization, we can help more people because there is a good coordination from public resource, private resource, and voluntary resource. We construction a telephone line, a specific telephone line for help, for ask help. And in particular, there is more intervention for violence, line for call help for violence, woman violence, children violence. And there is a very big problem by the infection in the house for old people. Because in particular, there is two centers of big explosion, the infection, the hospital, and the house for older people. Now, in Italy, 2 months ago, there is a big problems about the sanitary procedures, mask, hand, and a lot of people have had the infection for this reason. Now the situation is better, but it's this the reason because we have a big explosion of infection in Italy. Social worker work a lot, work very, very hard, because in Italy it's the same situation. We have a big economic problems because there is a lockdown from 2 months ago, and economic system go down, a lot go down. More people, more family not work, not have money, and they are at home. And social workers ask and give a lot of money for these people, in particular for to buy food, to buy expense, to buy the this situation. After the government understand this situation and put a lot of money for poor people. And there is extraordinary intervention for the poor now in Italy, but we ask help to Union Europe, because it's more and more important Italy can work in this direction, and not important the public debt, because the people is in very, very sufferance. And now the social work work okay, the intervention go very, very good, but the situation is so, so hard and so, so strong. After, there is another problem. In the future, we have a very, very big problem about mental health, because the situation for isolation, for economic problems, and for the closed a lot of work, it's possible a lot of fabric or shop will be open in the future, and a big explosion of unemployed and in the future. And now there is a problem by mental health, but in the future it's very, very possible the problem will be very, very big. And it's coming the suicide in Italy. We have a lot of problem in the population about it. Now there is a lot of call number for support the population about this problem. I think in the future in Italy will be very, very hard situation, because there is a very strong, strong crisis, economic, social, and a lot of people have aloof, have a dead of a family, and there is very, very preoccupation in the people. And the future will be a very, very big crisis for mental health. A social worker, it's in action, it's now good organization, but the future will be very, very strong.
Paola, we need to cut one more minute.
Can please?
Yeah, one minute.
Yeah.
Just to okay. Summarize. Yeah.
Excuse me.
Just saying one. Just one more minute, please.
Okay.
Paola, can you hear me?
Yes.
There was a question asking, do you have many homes for children?
Yes, we have many homes for children, and in this situation there is a lot of presidios, a lot of vigils, yes, and this situation of lockdown, it will be a lot of problem in the family, in a violence family, and go on the distance from the children and the parents, because there is a big problems by violence. And the number of children in the home, it's more now. It's a very difficult situation for children, and in particular for handicapped children. The children who has a mental health disturb, the children is difficult, in difficulty in family, because there isn't school open. And the children stay in the family all the day, every day. And this is very, very difficult. There is a very, very problems.
Yeah, I think that's an issue all over. So Paola, thank you very much. I'm sure there'll be more questions towards the end, but I think we should move on to our next speaker.
Thank you.
And thank you, Paola. So I'd like to invite Carla Frazio, and I'm hoping that I'm pronouncing that correctly. Carla is from Portugal, mm-hmm. and she's working in the field of addiction, works for the Ministry of Health and the Tagus Valley Regional Health Administration. So Carla, can you open your microphone?
Yes. Carla Frazão, in Portuguese, but very good. Thank you so much.
Close, but no.
Yeah, very close, very close. Well, I don't know if I can spell your name also. Brian Aslander? Okay, thank you so much for the invitation to be part of this webinar. Like you said, I work in a division that is responsible for prevention, harm reduction, treatment, and social reinsertion of persons with addictive behaviors. And my presentation was made by me and a colleague of mine, Cristina Proença, that is also here presenting and assisting this webinar. And we work at the coordination team of this division. Our service, like I said, has persons and treats persons who have addictive behaviors, the majority related to alcohol, cannabis, heroin, and cocaine. It coordinates 8 units at a regional level. 2 of them include physical withdrawal centers and 1 therapeutic community, and around 18 adult treatment centers and 17 adolescent young indicated prevention centers. Okay. Our teams are multidisciplinary. We work essentially with psychiatrists, psychologists, nurses, and other health staff. And the organization of this webinar launched to as a challenge to express what were the welfare strategies that Portugal adopted to deal with the crisis. And me and my colleague Cristina, we emphasized the ones that had more impact towards our patients in our teams. There were developed help to homeless people, most of them with addictive behaviors, alcohol abuse and other dependencies, and with mental health issues also. Several emergency shelters were created specifically at this time. We have some of them in the city of Lisbon, but more were needed to be created because some of the homeless people didn't access these shelters. They were on the streets. And they were living with the money that was given when they parked cars or something like that, and they stopped having that kind of money. It was necessary to create a strategy that could prevent overdoses or severe withdrawal syndromes. Alcohol syndrome can lead to death. And our alcohol unit, and Paulo Olas, also a colleague of ours, is assisting here, were necessary to make some plans to prevent this kind of situations in homeless people with other teams, health teams that is are being supported, but also with street harm reduction teams that are approaching these homeless people at the streets. One of the other strategies that we think it was important for Portugal, I don't know if it happened in your countries, towards prison inmates, persons that were in prison, if they had committed minor crimes or had fulfilled most of the time in prison, they to prevent the spread of COVID-19 in the prisons, they were sent home before the end of the time, for example. And we have right now assessing to our teams some of these prison inmates that were using methadone, for example. They were in treatment in jail also, and they are assessing right now to our teams. Labor market, some strategies, not enough yet, but to prevent unemployment were taken in account, and to guarantee basic support economic to persons who have no income at this time. But not enough also. But one thing that we thought it was positive, and I don't know, I think it happened with you also, municipalities and the local institutions mobilized themselves in a very solidarity way to help in a free way most of the persons who need more attention, persons with chronic diseases, older persons to have access to food and medication and prevent their renting out from home, for example. In our service, DICAD, we produced several documents that were orientation for doctors and nurses and to prioritize some of our interventions. And in that same way, we elaborated an orientation document that was made at coordination level, but with the help of our colleague of unit, alcohol unit, to define priorities of social intervention with our patients and families. We define that all our patients that have health fragilities, such as HIV, tuberculosis, and other organic disease, must have special attention to guarantee they receive at their home food and medication and minimize their absence from home. As well, defines prioritization in first attendance to persons in a situation of homeless or connected to domestic violence also, or a child at risk, pregnant, etc. My colleagues are contacting these patients and that were prioritized essentially by phone. We have our colleagues working 50-50. Sometimes they are scaled at teams, but in the teams we have very low attendance, okay? Only emergency situations. One of the challenges also that you made to me was to explain how digital literacy were increased in this time. Obviously, I think it's obvious for you and us that digital literacy increased. People didn't do Zoom meetings, didn't do reunions online, and we passed to do that reunions online right now. We also have in our service a multidisciplinary informatics system that it was used before this pandemic. It's a health national system specific for addictive behaviors, where we put the patient agenda with all technicians involved, clinical diary, social diary. But in relation to social work, we have an area where we introduce social diagnosis and where we evaluate social outcomes of our intervention based in a social reinsertion model, which includes a definition of an individual reinsertion plan. Our social workers introduce data in regard to their patients, but is a challenge because the majority have more than 40 years old. We are getting older in our service, and low digital competences. Training has been necessary all the time, where our coordination team has an essential function, and Christina Parenza essentially. In the coordination team, we have also social workers that do statistical analysis, SPSCS, and we use this tool to evaluate outcome results of projects of interventions. For example, we made a study about homeless people that are attended in our alcohol unit. It was presented in a poster last year in Lisbon Addictions Congress. In parallel to SIM and with COVID pandemic, we decided to create a regional database. It's an Excel document, a simple Excel document that is shared in our drive of Microsoft service, and where we decided, because it started emerging several resources specific to respond to COVID situations, and we decided to share it at regional level because we are 30 social workers, and we have distance from 200 kilometers, for example, for you to understand it. And this document has the object, it's a dynamic source available in the drive. Every social worker can introduce information, and the information is available to all at the same time. If one social worker from a town gets sick, or it's necessary to have a contingency plan for us, I can be working in my house or in another team and give support to the team that is 100 kilometers from me, for example.
Carla, we have about another minute to go.
Okay, I'm finishing.
Okay.
The type of information collected has to do with contacts of institutions and social resources that are essential to deal with our patients' social and health needs. The data doesn't have names of patients, and for that, no ethical issues emerged. This resource, it has been a challenge because the majority of our social workers didn't use a lot of Excel documents, but assumed the potential of the resource and understood the importance of this digital tool that we were not using before. We didn't use it before. The COVID made us create this kind of software. The technology, sometimes it's a problem because in some teams, internet and hardware are not quite actualized. But this Excel document allows to know what resources are being created at local level, and it allows to share with different social workers different strategies that are being used and good practices. Obtain this knowledge, facilitate the solution of problems identified that can be applied in different situations that enrich our social work. For example, our schools are closed, I think yours also, but families that had economic vulnerabilities and before pandemic had support to free meals are maintaining this support. On the other hand, food supplies have decreased, and our patients specifically, even with no children, were allowed to have access to school meals when it wasn't the purpose. It was a solution created in some areas where there were no food supply, for example, and school became a solution, for example. In summary, social workers had to reinvent other alternatives in order to guarantee basic social needs and social support. Thank you.
Carla, thank you very much. There was a comment in our that I just saw that it's amazing how similar your situation is to what's going on in Israel.
Yeah.
And I think we could say that almost all over the world. We're all dealing with many of the same issues.
Yes.
So thank you very much, and
thank
we
you.
Will move on to our next presenter, Tzipora Rosenberg, who is a social worker in a supervised visitation center in Jerusalem. Tzipora will present some of the unique challenges of maintaining supervised visitation under these circumstances and the use of video and Zoom to help non-custodial parents keep up their visitation. So, Tzipora, thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm going to give a little explanation about our service. We treat three different groups. We have children from divorced homes that come to meet their parents. It could be either their father or mother. We have children that are in foster homes that would come sometimes to meet both parents. And we have children that are living with their mother in shelters for battered women shelters. And they will come to meet each other under our supervision according to the decision of the courts. And of course, when the COVID-19 came around, we understood two things. The first thing was, of course, that we cannot have the people come and meet physically anymore and endanger each other or the staff. But the second thing that we understood was the great importance of close family relationships, especially in difficult and stressful times like this, as a source of support. And trying to face the challenges and dealing with these things, we offer the families to keep relationships using either the platform of Zoom conversations or conference calls. Of course, having us as the social workers still online and on the video together with the families and following what's going on. So I'm working in the municipality of Jerusalem, which provided us cameras, computers, any facilities we needed. And we gave the families a choice, either using the Zoom application or just regular conference calls, according to the capabilities of each family, according to their culture or lifestyle. We have high percentages of family who would not use Zoom due to religious reasons or cultural reasons. And so we used phone calls for those families. We were very surprised to see that although we thought the conversations would be very short and it would be very difficult to maintain such relationships, we found ourselves on the phone call or Zoom up to an hour with the families and children that were very excited to speak to their beloveds. And we're happy to see the families learning the new skill and using it. We also faced a lot of challenges in the new tool, such as families who had a difficulty keeping a conversation for more than 5 minutes, and how do we help them just by using words to keep on a conversation longer than that. So we offered them songs they could sing with each other, or different word games such as Guess Who, 20 Questions, Name 5. The Zoom enabled us to play tic-tac-toe, ik-sigul, when you have the ability of sharing a screen, sharing the white blackboard, which both sides could draw on it at the same time, and different ideas like that. We had another challenge that had to do with the environment of the child or of the parents. What happens when we get the parents on the Zoom meeting and he's dressed inappropriately in his own house or his own bedroom? What happens when the child is in an environment where there are other things that we don't want the parents to get exposed to, especially if it's foster children, and we want to keep the privacy of the foster parents, no pictures or names that could give some details that we don't want. What happens when we have people that are unexpected and that join the meeting, such as, let's say, stepbrothers or sisters or different family members, which the kid is not in touch with and we don't want them to join, and suddenly we have less control on who joins the meeting. We had some problems that had to do with lack of respect of families to the meeting. If we call and no, there's no answer, or the phone is not charged, noises, the child is in the middle of something else and cannot come to the phone. So I would say that we understood that we have to set up new rules for the new situation and understand that the change of setting brings its own challenges and has a great impact on the families. But I do want to say that we also saw a big advantages that had to do with more intimacy between the sides that is connected to the fact that the conversation is in their own environment and the child sometimes could show his parents his bedroom, his bed, his drawers, his closets, his toys, and parents could show their children their home, their living room, their kitchen. And we felt that it also brought something new and different into the lives of these families that they weren't used to before. And we hope, you know, to start getting them back to meet each other in our center.
Okay, Sipora, thank you very much. That was certainly, I'm sure you've, it's a way of working that you never considered in the past.
No.
I'm trying to think. There was a question. Let me just see. It says, how do you help with privacy issues when the custodial parent is against the meeting and the kids don't have the freedom to meet the non-custodial parent?
So that was one of our main challenges. Of course, so we at first try to explain and try to ask the parents if we felt that he was bothering the meeting to let the child have his own privacy to have the relationship with his other parents. Not in all cases it worked, I must admit. The majority of our families appreciated the opportunity we gave them, but not all. And we had a few families which we had to bring back either to court or to the social worker that's in charge of the case and have to solve the problems specifically for that family.
Okay. Great. Let me just see for a moment. There was a comment, if I understand it correctly, from Ireland, that some foster parents use a different SIM card to do a video call for a visit with parents. It has been a great comfort to some of the birth parents to see their children's bedroom, and they can really see how well the child is looked after, which has helped to improve the relationships between the birth family and the foster family. Anyway, just a comment from Ireland, or I should say also an idea that could be used. Okay, wait just a moment. So I see we had a Barbara Lang wanted to make a comment or ask a question. Barbara, do you want to open your microphone?
Yeah, I did. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So I work for the Ministry of Health. I'd just like to talk a couple of minutes about what we're doing in the Ministry of Health, because we're dealing not only with clients, but also with healthcare workers, which was mentioned at the beginning, because they have a lot of fears, both of bringing COVID-19 home, of possibly bringing it into the institutions that they work in, and maybe making healthy patients who have come in for other health issues sick because they've brought it in, which we've found has been happening in nursing homes and in other areas. We work in a lot of different fields, both mental health, geriatrics, general health, domestic violence, which was mentioned before. We're doing a lot of work. We've opened up lines for healthcare workers to call to get support. Which we found very important, because if they don't get the support, then they're not going to be able to help others. There's a national program for all types of work being done with the elderly, which has now unified various ministries that deal in different facets of care, which we're very, very involved with. There are helplines both for families to call. There are helplines for the various institutions to call, which is very important. Mental health programs have been started for the general population, and also we're having to deal with families who have not been able to see either people who have mental health issues and have been institutionalized or geriatric facilities, because the Ministry of Health decided that there can be no outside visits except for people working, for the fear of bringing COVID-19 into these institutions. And again, I think that if I think even 5 or 10 years ago, that a meeting like this could be held with dozens or I don't remember how many people are on this call from all over the world is quite amazing. And I think that we're all learning to deal, whether it's with Zoom or conference calls or whatever other internet media that we're using, has become very, very helpful. And I want to thank everyone who organized this meeting and all the people from all over the world. And I've had other contacts with people in New York, and we all seem to be dealing with the same issues. And I think that's a great help for us to hear that we're not the only ones, and we can also learn from each other. And I think that's very, very important that we do learn from each other. And thank you very much for the meeting. That's all I want to say.
Okay, Barbara, thank you very much for the information. There was a question that perhaps Anna can answer, Anna Radulescu from the International Federation of Social Workers, of what kind of professional support and training have social workers received worldwide regarding this unique crisis? Anna, I don't know if you have any idea, but can you?
I
as far as I have information, nobody received any kind of training to face such a situation. I work in emergency interventions, and I never heard that social workers are prepared for such kind of intervention. So maybe some of the social workers are working in, for example, in hospitals in emergency situation, and they have a little bit of training. I was with social workers in different, but very small trainings, how to answer disasters, natural disasters, or but never about this kind of pandemic. Therefore, the only training we social workers started to have was the one with the first day of pandemic in Europe. So we started to learn from each other. We started to have meetings online, and we have to share experiences. IFSW Europe had a kind of help desk during this time, and we receive a lot of questions from social workers from all over Europe, asking us if we know practice somewhere else in other countries dealing with the same situation. So we had the possibility to share from a country to another, but all the trainings we had, it happened. I think, you know, training, what does mean training? To sit in a class and listen. I think for us sharing, learning from each other during this time, it was a kind of training. And this is a part of a training of social workers sharing experiences. What I can tell you is that I'm surprised to see how fast we learn from each other. And where Barbara was talking, I was thinking that yes, we are dealing with almost the same issue in our countries. And I'm surprised to see that we have the same answer. Somehow we created the same answer. We have different resources. We put money in a part or other. We are investing more in specific approaches, but we are having the same approach. And for me, this is something really amazing that we are doing the same thing, even we never been trained together. So I think right now we are having a training.
Okay, Anna, thank you very much. And thank you to all of our presenters, all of our participants. Herbert would like one word, I see.
Thank you, Brian, for allowing me to say something. I would like to add something to Anna's comment. When I started to be a practitioner in social work more than 40 years ago, most of our clients did not have a phone. So we sent letters, written letters, which took 2 or 3 days, and the answer took another 2 or 3 days. Then the phone was more used. Then the mobile phone came. Now we are using emails. I think, first of all, we as social workers, our main tool is personal relationship, creating a professional personal relationship to our clients. And we use the accessible tools. Now we have to adapt. We have new techniques, new methods, new infrastructure to get in contact. But in fact, it's the same. The only difference is the dimension. We are a little bit surprised how big it is, but we are doing it this for so many years. Another small difference is that not for the first time, but much more than before, we as social workers are under risk for infection, for example. But it had happened before. I remember when I was working with drug addicts, there was the risk for hepatitis. So it's nothing new, not at all. We just have to learn from the past and to adapt to the new situation. And it's very helpful to hear, not only tonight, but also in other webinars, how people adapt in different countries, in different professional environments, institutional framework, and so on, to this new situation. But in fact, it's not that new. We know everything we need to know. We just have to use it. and it helps a lot to exchange the experience. Thanks for organizing this seminar, this webinar.
Thank you, Herbert. We have, of course, run over the amount of time that we allowed. I think some of the comments in the chat that's going on that we have not been able to relate to are fascinating, and we're going to have to see how we can make that available to everybody who's who just like to read them through. Some of the questions, some of the comments were really very interesting. So we will send, just to reiterate, we will send to everybody the presentation, the slideshow, the results of the survey, and a link to this recorded webinar so that everybody can use. Finally, I'd like to give a special thanks to the team that organized the webinar. The survey was actually the brainchild of Rinat Salem, who works in the Jerusalem municipality in the Community Services Administration. She is the Director of Knowledge Management and Organizational Learning. And I think we have certainly shared a lot of knowledge and hopefully learned from this webinar. To Lihi Raviv, who is the Digital Transformations Manager at JDC Israel for all of her input and help in organizing. For Aviv Landau, who really looked over all of the results and was able to pull out some of the, I could say the hidden gems. When you have 200 responses, some of them are open questions. It can be difficult. You can get lost very easily. So Aviv, thank you. And finally, thanks to Miri Zohar from the JDC also for the technical assistance in making this meeting happen. And thanks to everybody who, actually, you also stuck around. I see there, I mean, there's 125 people still online out of maybe 140 people who signed on originally. So hopefully that means that this was really interesting for everybody. It certainly was interesting to me. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much also. Bye-bye.
Thank you to everybody. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
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 Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Some good news.
When I wake up in the morning, love. The sunlight hurts my eyes, and something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind. Yeah, I love you, and the world's all right for me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. Impossible. someone else instead of me. Always seems to know the way. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. And when someone else instead of me always seems to know the way, then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. I just want to look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day.
רגע, אני עוצרת את ההקלטה.
כן, תעצרי. רגע, אני אשמור את הצ'אט. איפה זה שומר?